Good morning. I recently participated in a roundtable on how to promote peace and stability in the Asia-Pacific region. This was part of the 9th Beijing Shukshan Forum held on the 21st and 22nd of October in Beijing. Now, basically, the issue here at the roundtable and at the forum was that today we have two competing security architectures. There is one architecture called the Asia-Pacific architecture, which is China-inspired, and there is another architecture which is America-led, and that is the Indo-Pacific architecture. Now, the key thing about is these two architectures is they are very different, except that both of them believe that ASEAN should be the core of their narrative. The big difference comes is that the American architecture, the American and the democracies, they say that China does not respect international law. But of course, the unsaid reason is that whichever architecture eventually, let's say in about 10 years from now, prevails in the region will have a very large say. That particular country, either China or America, will have a very big say in the geopolitics, geoeconomics, and geostrategy of the entire Asia-Pacific rim. To my mind, India has not positioned itself at all to benefit from either of the narratives. But that I will come to later. I will also talk later what was said at the forum, because first we need to get these two models correct. What is the core? What is the core thinking of these two models? So let's start with the China-inspired model, the Asia-Pacific. Now, the interesting thing about this model is it already has a defined strategy. Strategy basically means it has defined a roadmap, and it has a mechanism also to accomplish that strategy. And both of them are enshrined in the Belt and Road Initiative. So we have to see a bit about this Belt and Road. What is this? Now, Belt and Road is a very interesting concept in the sense that China is offering countries who join the Belt and Road prosperity. Now, which country would deny prosperity? In that, what they are saying is that we will help you develop your economy, help you develop your infrastructure, your roads, your ports, your highway, we'll do all that. Not only that, we will help you with the funds also, and the funds will come from AIIB bank, which has maximum Chinese stakes, and the One Belt, One Road Fund. Now, the Chinese are promising much more than this. In addition to the infrastructure, there is the Digital Silk Road, which was incorporated in 2015 in the Belt and Road concept. Now, as part of the Digital Silk Road, what they are offering is an entirely different ball game. Take that nation to the digital age, which means now we are talking of in a globalized world, in a world connected by internet, we are talking of e-commerce. We are talking of rapid progress of the nation as a whole. Now, in that, what they are saying is, and in South Asia, where except for India and Bhutan, who have not signed the Belt and Road, and the other nations are on board, the Chinese have already started laying the submarine cables, the fiber optic cables. They have already started laying the internet infrastructure with Huawei 5G very soon coming in. Then they have also promised that once Beidou, the constellation system of the Chinese, once it goes global, which is next year in 2020, those nations will be part of it. In other words, they are taking the nation to a different level altogether. The unsaid part here is that look, even because China is today competing with America in the fourth industrial revolution, which is the age of artificial intelligence, so the benefits, the gains of artificial intelligence will also be available on the commercial side to all these countries. So this is the big thing package that they are offering. So what does China get in return? Two things. Number one, China will increase its info space, which is the information space. And this makes a lot of sense in the age of artificial intelligence. What you need is data, data and more data and more data. So this is what Chinese will get from these nations by doing all the digital, laying the infrastructure for them. The second thing what the Chinese are saying is that because the prosperity of a nation and the security of a nation are not divisible, so they are offering a cooperative security to these nations. That look, we will also help you secure your assets. Now, this is all very interesting because in any case, one of the key tasks of the PLA is that wherever the Chinese people are there, Chinese infrastructure is there, Chinese interests is there abroad, they will go and protect that. So as part of that cooperative security, then there will be more military to military and security to security agencies cooperation between the PLA and the nation which has joined the Belt and Road. Now, it is not very difficult to extrapolate and say 10 years from now, how will the things look? Things could be something like the two militaries have very intense interaction. Then there could be arms sales. Chinese have today a vibrant, a flourishing defense industry. That could be to those nations. There could be interoperability. And we could be talking of an entirely different ballgame where we could have PLAF and PLAN assets, which is the PLA Air Force, PLA Navy assets, also with consent of the concerned nations, they coming and for logistics reasons, they coming to that country, ports and harbors. So when we see all this, and this is all real, when we see all this happening 10 years from now, considering that Belt and Road already has, it started moving in 2013. When we see all this, the picture that looks is something like this, that India and Bhutan, especially India as a big nation, which has rejected the Belt and Road, will perhaps not be encircled by China in its neighborhood. It will be something like a strategic irrelevance of India in its neighborhood. So some wisdom India has to gain from perhaps the Japanese model. The Japanese, short of signing the Belt and Road, today are cooperating in infrastructure with the Chinese, but this a little later. So this basically what I said is the Chinese inspired model. Now let's talk of the US led, which is the Indo-Pacific model. Now the problem with the Indo-Pacific model or narrative is that it is still a concept. It has no strategy, it has no mechanism yet. And the reason is, it just came about on the 30th May 2018, when officially America announced the change of name of its PACCOM from US Pacific Command to US Indo-Pacific Command. And the reason why they have come late in the game is because they rejected what was already a good game going on, already a fantastic model to compete with the Belt and Road, and that was the Trans-Pacific Partnership, TPP, Trans-Pacific Partnership, on which the Obama administration worked for 6 years. In fact, you know, the TPP model came about around the time when China rise was assured, when the democracies felt that China was being aggressive in the region, in the Asia-Pacific region. So the TPP had two components, clearly defined components. There was a military component and there was a development and an economic component. Unfortunately, the development component did not get highlighted, but the military component, which was first called the pivot. Now, pivot is very military term. Basically saying pivot is that now we will, which of course, is if you see the American understanding of defense, it is based on deterrence, which basically means that we will have our military power at a place. And for Asia Pacific, the second component always was that we will strengthen our alliances and we will strengthen our partnerships. So this is what the concept of deterrence always has been for this Asia Pacific region. So in the TPP, what was called the pivot first, then they mellowed it down and started calling it rebalancing, basically bringing about 60% of the assets of the entire US military for the US Pacific Command, now of course the US Indo-Pacific Command. So this model was doing well till the Trump administration came and they withdrew from the TPP. This, I think, was something which was completely unexpected by the other 11 partners, US being the 12th partner of TPP. Especially the country which got the maximum jolt was Japan. So once Trump withdrew from that, and around that time, you see, a lot had already happened. The situation on the ground had changed drastically. And when I say drastically, what had happened was, starting 2015 and in about 2-3 years time, China had actually won the South China Sea and America had lost it. This was the truth. So all this talk about US military analyst about first island chain, second island chain, third island chain, I mean, this really didn't count for much. In a fantastic strategy of this stick and carrot through the Belt and Road, the Chinese were able to just take over the entire South China Sea, and they were ready now to break out or to come into the Indian Ocean, where in any case, since 2008, they had been doing their regular voyages. And the reason, ostensible reason, was anti-piracy was being done right till the Gulf of Aden. And then in 2017, they created their first military base. They called it Logistic Support Base in Djibouti. So by this time, in these 10 years, 2008 to 2018, the Chinese had already tested the endurance of their long vessels across the entire Indian Ocean region. And they already, the crews were conversant with the sea lanes of communications, because in any case, this 21st Maritime Silk Road of the Chinese, which is part of the Belt and Road, it runs alongside the traditional sea lanes of communications. So the Chinese were already breaking out into the Indian Ocean, which basically means that next what they were looking at is the Bay of Bengal, the Andaman Sea. India's Andaman and Nicobar Command now appeared absolutely vulnerable. And on the other side, the western side, there were the Pacific nations, which in any case, with their look north policy, were quite happy to join the Belt and Road in some way with the Chinese. Now, it was under these circumstances that President Trump, after rejecting the TPP, he visited Japan. This was in May 2017. Now, it was then that this concept, apparently this Indo-Pacific concept, was the brainchild of the Japanese. And the Japanese discussed, Prime Minister Abe discussed this with President Trump, but there was disagreement in two areas. The first disagreement was that the Japanese wanted this concept, this narrative of Indo-Pacific, to extend right till the African continent. Basically, they wanted the entire Eurasia and they wanted the African continent to be part of this. Whereas insofar as the Americans were concerned, they wanted to stop at the Indian Ocean region, didn't want to go beyond that. So there was this problem. The second problem was that Abe was not very enthused by the concept of Quad. Now, Quad is that short form for quadrilateral interaction between four democracies: India, US, Japan, and Australia. Because he felt that this could have a militarized version in it, inbuilt into it, and this would displease or annoy the Chinese, which he didn't want to do. So he was more inclined towards the infrastructure building part, the development part, which is not something that President Trump was looking at. So in any case, Japan was not really on board to begin with. And in the meantime, the Japanese Prime Minister had gone to China, met up with the Chinese leader, and he thought it was necessary to cooperate with China in some way. So as I said, short of Belt and Road, Japan and China agreed to work together for infrastructure building. One of their projects is a smart city in Thailand. I mean, they are having problems, but I'm sure they can overcome that. So the idea is that Japanese decided to play it both sides. Now, coming back to under these circumstances, what I said, what came about was the Indo-Pacific concept, the narrative, which came into being once the PACCOM was renamed. Now, where did India fit into all this? Now, this is very interesting, because with India, the Americans have been doing cooperation, especially the naval cooperation, right till since 1992. And I remember in a one-on-one with the then Pacific PAC commander, Admiral Harry Harris, in Delhi, where he spoke to me for nearly an hour. The sum total of his talk was, his discussion was, that he was looking at India to become a pivot in the Indian Ocean region, which is much more than saying that the American want India to be a net security provider. Net security provider has more to do with the non-traditional, the security things like disaster relief, tsunami, such things. Pivot is a militarized word. So I asked him, I said, Admiral, what is this pivot about? Where does it take? What is the end game? He told me that the end game is we are looking at interoperability with India for combat patrols in the Indian Ocean region. Now, this is a very big thing, and considering the state of or the position of India's naval defense industry and the capabilities, it is a Herculean task to do. But having said that, Indians obviously were not very happy to go whole hog, but they were happy to talk about security. They were happy to talk about the economic aspects, the development aspects. And that is what the Indians have done. In other words, the problem with this Indo-Pacific narrative is that, first of all, it has come too late in the day compared to the Belt and Road. Number two, it does not still have a strategy. It does not still have a mechanism. It is still a concept. So that is what we are looking at. Now, I want to talk about a bit about India in this. Now, insofar as India is concerned, it becomes very clear, as I mentioned, that we have a problem there in South Asia 10 years from now. We have another problem, which is right now there. And the right now problem is, I must talk about the CPEC a bit, China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, which the Chinese say is the flagship of the Belt and Road. Now, here I must say, and I must show admiration for Pakistani ruler General Musharraf, who did great service for his nation. After the 1999 Kargil conflict in 2000, he's the one who approached the Chinese and offered the Chinese to build a deep sea port in Gawadar, something that President Ayub, is one of his predecessors, wanted to do, make it into a an air and naval hub. So the Chinese were happy to do that. So I think that one step did really wonders today. Now, when we see today as things stand, Gawadar, the first phase is over. That was over in 2009. After that, the Chinese took over the port facilities. Now we are talking about plan, the PLA Navy ships being there. We are talking about a lot of pressure on the Indian Navy. Indian Navy, instead of helping or supporting the land war, will be very hard pressed to even safeguard our own commercial vessels in the sea lanes of communication with the planned ships being there in Gawadar. Not only that, the CPEC also really owes its origin to the Gawadar deal. Because once Gawadar came about, then the Chinese would have thought that it's a great idea. Let's have this CPEC, and the Pakistanis were very happy. Today, what has happened is at the northern end of the CPEC, there is interoperability going on, and this is North Ladakh I'm talking of, which is India's vulnerability. There is interoperability going on between the Pakistan military and PLA. They have annual exercises, special forces exercises, they have annual air force exercises, the Shaheen series. Now, when you put all this in perspective, this is a threat which has magnified a lot because of that one thing that General Musharraf did. How it has built up, it's amazing, it's so interesting to see. And this threat will only continue to magnify and multiply. But this is not the subject right now. So the point here is that India, honestly, in both the narratives, the one narrative which has already gone so much ahead, the Chinese inspired narrative and the American narrative, it has not positioned itself wholeheartedly in either of them. So, which really puts India into a very difficult position. Perhaps, as I said, it will be wise for India to look at Japan's example. Japan, being an ally, a military ally of US, has been sensible enough to be also part of development building with China. So India could consider a thing which came out of the Wuhan summit, which is the China India Plus mechanism. I think this perhaps could be one of a good ways of India ensuring that it remains geopolitically relevant in the region. Now, coming back to the forum, what I want to say is a very interesting thing. This forum, what the Chinese normally do, because I have attended five of these forums, this was my fourth forum that I attended. The format usually is that the Chinese defense minister gives the keynote address, and after that the plenary session starts. This time they made a deviation. They had two keynote speakers. Immediately after the Chinese defense minister, the Russian defense minister Sergei Shoigu was also invited to speak as a keynote speaker. Now, he, given the strategic relations, the deep and thick relation, I mean, today I would compare the relations of China and Russia with the ties between something between China and Pakistan. With such deep strategic ties, and he fully supporting the China inspired concept of Asia Pacific, this is what he had to say. He said, quote, "India Pacific strategy is vague. It does not include all nations in the region. It is an alliance of interest with grave consequences. It will undermine multilateralism. It will harm common security concerns by not strengthening the cooperation from all the nations." And he said, this will also lead to an arms race. Basically, now of the three strategic players today in the world, geostrategic players, which is Russia, China, and US, two are supporting the security architecture, which is the China inspired security architecture with the Belt and Road strategy, and which already has made a lot of progress. And the Americans, basically, I believe personally that it is because they abandoned the TPP somewhere and then they started moving on a different track. So they seem to be lagging behind. Now, this security architecture will be very relevant, very important to see how things unfold in this region and for India also. Thank you.